He is a member of many scientific societies and potential reviewer of many international journals. He has completed many projects and having ongoing projects as well. The total cost around 1 crore. He is a doctoral committee member of various universities. So with that, I ask all the participants to give your full attention to Dr. N. Jayakumaran and make this afternoon as an interactive one. Now I request Dr. N. Jayakumaran to carry over the session. Sir, please.
Yes, good afternoon, everybody. It is one of the fine afternoon. We are going to have a wonderful 2 days program from St. Joseph's Engineering College, who are doing a wonderful job towards this young and energetic peoples of Tamil Nadu and nearby Tamil Nadu and all over India, all over the world. Only due to this COVID-19, which made all of us to be here within home for the past more than 60 days. So in this juncture, we are attending many conferences, many programs throughout Tamil Nadu, throughout many... going to give a talk on a topic, nanotechnology in energy-based applications. So this is the field that is the energy, which is the hot area of this throughout the world. We are all thinking about the energy is the energy in one way. We are all thinking about that is it is one of the very simple concept or toughest compass or whatever it may be. But very in as a scientific way, we are all going to give you a brief introduction about what is the energy. So this is a picture shows that is the energy consumption throughout the past more than 60,000 years. Our cultural change, our technological advancement and technological concepts make us to use the energy usage more and more, more and more, more, more. In this picture, we started from the year, from the ancient days. That is why we have seen some 1,00,000 BC. And the period of the year, the how much energy they used. They used energy only for their food. மரங்களிலும் கிளைகளிலும் அங்கங்கே தோட்ட மரங்கள்ல இருக்கிறத பறிச்சு சாப்பிடுவாங்க. அவங்க ஒன்றும் வேற ஒன்றும் எனர்ஜி இல்லை. பழங்கள் சாப்பிடுவாங்க, தண்ணியை குடிப்பாங்க, தே வில் ஜஸ்ட் டேக் ரெஸ்ட், அவ்வளோதான். சூரியன் மறைஞ்சிச்சுன்னா ரெஸ்ட். தென் ஆஃப்டர் தேட் தே கோ ஃபார் ஹண்டிங், உணவை தேடி அலைந்த அந்த வேட்டையாடும் காலம் அடுத்து வந்தது. தே கோ ஃபார் ஹண்டிங் டுவர்ட்ஸ் அனிமல்ஸ் அண்ட் அதர் திங்ஸ். அதுக்கடுத்த ஸ்டேஜ் வந்து தே கோ ஃபார் அக்ரிகல்ச்சர் and maintaining the pet animals. அதுக்கு கொஞ்சம் எனர்ஜி யூசேஜ் கொஞ்சம் கூடுச்சு. இப்படியே வர டெவலப்டு ஃபார்மராக வர்றப்ப ஹீ கேன் யூஸ் மோர் அண்ட் மோர் எனர்ஜி. அப்போ அந்த எனர்ஜி யூசேஜ் இஸ் கோஸ் ஆன் இன்க்ரீஸிங் பை த வேர்ல்ட்ஸ் கல்ச்சுரல் அண்ட் டெக்னாலஜிக்கல் யூசேஜ் மாறிக்கிட்டே வரப்ப மாறிக்கிட்டே இருக்கும். ஸோ நவ் த டெக்னாலஜிக்கல் மேன் வளர்ந்து அதுக்கப்புறம் அவர் ஹையர் டெக்னாலஜிக்கல் மேன் இந்த இன்னைக்கு இருக்க ட்ரெண்டில் வி ஆர் யூஸிங் ஜஸ்ட் we are using more and more, that is around some 28% of the world population composed 77% of energy population. நீ உலகத்தில் இருக்கக்கூடிய மொத்த மக்கள் தொகை கிட்டத்தட்ட 638 crores பீப்புளில் ஒன்லி ஜஸ்ட் 28% இஸ் யூஸிங் 77% ஆஃப் எனர்ஜி. த ஆல் த ஹியூமன் பாப்புலேஷன் யூஸிங் எனர்ஜி, யூஸ்டு எனர்ஜி ஆர் மெயின்லி ஃபார் எனர்ஜி ஃபார் டிரான்ஸ்போர்ட், இண்டஸ்ட்ரி, அக்ரிகல்ச்சர், டொமஸ்டிக், commercial and education, all these concepts area. So that energy usage goes on increasing, we should go for the energy production. So energy production and okay or kalatha nokki po aarambichom ena energy indradhu vandu we are nama what is the type of energy we are commonly using, that is the electrical energy mostly. Most of the world in ulagathil and 28% makkal 77% aatchala payanpaduthraanga abindra andha vishayam varrappave andha 77% they are using more than 60-80% electrical energy. அவங்களோட வீடு, அவங்க இருக்கக்கூடிய ஆஃபீஸ், அவங்க படிக்கக்கூடிய சூழல், வாட் எவர் இட் மே பி, தேர் வேர்ல்ட் இஸ் ஃபில்ட் அப் வித் எலக்ட்ரிக்கல் எனர்ஜி. ஸோ தட் எலக்ட்ரிக்கல் எனர்ஜி கான்செப்ட் இஸ் மோஸ்ட்லி the usage of world's energy usage and the electrical energy transition pathina. So fossil fuel irundhe neenga non fossil fuel, that is the renewable non renewable to renewable indha mari energy transition ulagathula neenga irundhukittirukku. Last or 50 to 60 years we are in the transition period. அதுக்கு முன்னாடி பார்த்தீங்கன்னா 200 and 250 இயர்ஸ் பேக் வி ஆர் இன் ட்ரான்சிஷன் பீரியட். ஓன்லி சன்லைட் அவர் நேச்சுரலாக இருக்கக்கூடிய லைட் அண்ட் ஹீட்டை மட்டும் தான் பயன்படுத்தணும். அதுக்கப்புறம் கோல் அண்ட் ஆயில் பிலோ த இயர் ஃபாசில் ஃபியூல்ஸ் கண்டுபிடிக்க பயன்படுத்தப்புறம் தட் இஸ் த ட்ரான்சிஷன் பீரியட் ஃப்ரம் 200-300 இயர்ஸ் பிஃபோர். அதுக்கப்புறம் இப்போ ஒரு 50 இயர்ஸாக குளோபல் வார்மிங் என்விரான்மெண்டல் ப்ரொடக்ஷன் அண்ட் டிப்ளிஷன் ஆஃப் ஃபாசில் ஃபியூல்ஸ் இந்த கான்செப்டெல்லாம் சேர்ந்து வி ஆர் புஷிங் டுவர்ட்ஸ் த ட்ரான்சிஷன் சேஞ்ச் ஃப்ரம் நான் ரினியூவபிள் டு renewable, that is the conventional to non-conventional form of energy, that is the solar, wind and other below earth kedaikkapudi energy la irundhu above earth kedaikkapudi energy ku vandirukkom. So this is the picture I already told. So ulagathula nikku irukkapudi old population la developed countries nu sollakudiya கிட்டத்தட்ட ஒரு 20% ஆஃப் த கண்ட்ரிஸ் தே ஆர் யூசிங் 60% ஆஃப் த எனர்ஜி. டெவலப்பிங் கண்ட்ரி ஆர் அன்டெவலப்டு கண்ட்ரி சொல்லக்கூடிய 80% ஆஃப் த கண்ட்ரிஸ் யூசிங் ஜஸ்ட் 40% ஆஃப் த வேர்ல்ட்ஸ் எனர்ஜி. இதுதான் ட்ரெண்டு. இன்னைக்கு இருக்க உலகமே கிட்டத்தட்ட ஒரு 20% நாடுகள் தான் அதிகப்படியான எனர்ஜியை யூஸ் பண்ணுறது, மோர் தேன் 60%. தட் இஸ் த டெவலப்டு கண்ட்ரி. டெவலப்டு கண்ட்ரி நம்ம சொன்னாலே பார்த்தீங்கன்னா மேற்கத்திய நாடுகள் தான். நம்மளாம் இன்னும் ஸ்டில் டெவலப்பிங் கண்ட்ரி, இந்தியா இஸ் ஸ்டில் டெவலப்பிங். என்னோட நம்மளோட சைல்டுஹுட்ல இருந்து எல்லாருமே கேள்விப்பட்ட ஒரு வார்த்தை, இந்தியா ஒரு வளரும் நாடு, இந்தியா ஒரு வளரும் நாடு. இன்னும் நம்ம வளர்ந்துகிட்டே தான் இருக்கோம். எப்போ நம்ம போன்விட்டா காம்ப்ளான்லாம் குடிச்சு நல்லா வளரப்போறோம் தெரியல. ஸோ தேட் மச் வி ஆர் ஸ்டில் டெவலப்பிங் கண்ட்ரி. அந்த டெவலப்பிங் அப்படின்ற அந்த வார்த்தை, டெவலப்புடுன்ற வார்த்தை எதில் அமையுதுன்னா த யூட்டிலைசேஷன் அண்ட் த இண்டிபெண்ட் ஆஃப் எனர்ஜி. அவங்களோட ஓன் எனர்ஜி ப்ரொடக்ஷன் எப்போ அவங்க செல்ஃப் சஸ்டைன்டாக மாறுறாங்களோ அந்த கண்ட்ரியெல்லாம் டெவலப்டு கண்ட்ரியாக மாறுது. ஒரு கண்ட்ரியோட பேஸுக்கு முக்கியமான அடிப்படையை எக்கனாமியாக இருக்கட்டும் என்விரான்மெண்டாக இருக்கட்டும், தட் இஸ் ஆல் பேஸ்ட் ஆன் எனர்ஜி. ஹலோ சார், சொல்லுங்க மேடம். இந்த அதனால நான் கொஞ்சம் இங்கிலீஷ்லேயே போனோம். ஓகே ஓகே, தேங்க்யூ 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 தேங்க்யூ. ஸோ this is the concept. That's why energy is the important concept throughout the world. This is the picture shows the household electricity consumption throughout the country. Each and every country using some this much kilowatt hour per year. Here Canada is using the most highest energy usage per year per individual. Similarly for our country India, we are using very, very in the lowest range. That is why our energy usage is below 1000. That is why in the above picture shows the worldwide the energy usage throughout the world, that is the countries above, the western countries and the USA, Canada, France and England and Australia, these are the countries using individual energy usage is more and more high. That is why energy is the important concept for the country's development. This is the picture shows the per capita primary power consumption, which is the one of the important concept, important valuable point for the human development index. That is the life expectancy and many years of schooling and expected years of schooling and gross national, these are all the human index. That is the health, education and living standards. These are all based on the energy index. That is the per capita primary power consumption. This picture shows where is the, our country India is located, just below 0.6, around some 0.54. Where is Norway, where is USA, where is Saudi Arabia, where is Russia, all above the 0.7 and above. Brazil is above around some 0.7. South Africa is below 0.6. That's why, so the energy development and energy usage and energy utilization, these are all the basic concepts for a developed country concept. That is why, that is energy related materials, energy related concept is very much important throughout for the current last 100 years. Here is the another picture shows the quality of life, that is the GDP per year per person using the energy consumption. This is for developing nations in the below power 5 around energy consumption per kilowatt, and that is the countries for developed nations. What are the energy sources we are commonly using? These are all the common concepts we already know, that is the renewable and non-renewable. In this concept, I am going to mainly highlight what are the energy materials, that is the nano concepts used in the solar energy based materials. We all know the importance of sun. Sun is the solar energy can be utilized in two categories. One is light energy, another is heat energy. Throughout the year, just a minute. Okay. The solar radiation satisfies our all the needs. One day, that is a 1 year, we can get the one solar energy. That is the 1 year solar energy can be utilized for 4,000 times over for throughout the year. The Earth's surface receives 120,000 terawatts of solar radiation, which represents 20,000 times more power than whole planet needs. That is why solar energy offers more benefits that make it one of the most promising energy forms, which is non-polluting and which is inexhaustible, which is avoids global warming and environmental friendly, eco-friendly, which reduces the fossil fuel usage, reduces the energy imports, generates the local wealth and jobs, contributes to sustainable development, which is the developed countries concept, and it is a modular and very versatile and adaptable different situation. You can use it anywhere and any place. You can use any solar equipment that is a thermal or photovoltaic. These are the solar energy technologies we commonly use, that is in the two categories. One is thermal category, another is photovoltaic technology. This photovoltaic technology we are commonly used, commonly known the principle and other things, because it is a very easily known concept, very easily reachable and concept in the area of solar energy. Because even a layman people can easily understand the concept. Solar is mainly a photovoltaic and other thing. But generally, solar is generally two categories. One is solar photovoltaic, another is solar thermal. The solar thermal consists of cooking of food, water heating, solar drying, and solar room heating, and solar power generation, and solar desalination. These are one of the biggest concepts towards solar thermal technology. But the research studies are very, very less in the front of solar thermal technology concepts. But most of the research is towards the solar photovoltaic concept, which is to simply convert the light energy into the electrical energy. So here I am going to give what are the solar thermal energy concepts and solar thermal energy applications, and what are the nanotechnology applications towards solar thermal energy equipment. And then I am going to the concept of solar photovoltaic nanotechnology applications. Here is the picture shows that harnessing solar energy for thermal applications, that is the domestic, industries, hotels, hospitals, and all other things. Use thermal energy for space heating, fluid heating, and generate electricity. So it can be very commonly, highly efficient concept of solar equipment. That is 60% efficiency is highly achievable in the solar thermal equipments, but in the photovoltaic category, only up to the 28% is the maximum efficiency in lab condition, and the commercial condition, it will be around some 24%. This is the another concept I'm going to present on the solar thermal first. Solar thermal is a basic concept of absorbing the solar heat energy, that is the mainly the visible region and the IR region of the solar electromagnetic spectrum area. For the solar thermal, we have to need the basic concept. One is good absorbing material and good heat transfer material and minimum heat loss material. This is the basic concept, basic principle of a solar thermal equipment. And for this, we are using different type of solar thermal equipment, that is whether it is a flat plate or evacuative or parabolic, or that is called the focusing type, concentrated type focusing solar collectors. These type of yes, these solar collectors have the based on the temperatures we have categorized into the two. Focusing collectors are produced up to the maximum temperature up to 100, 150, and 300 to 2000 degrees centigrade. That below 300 to 2000 degrees centigrade, high temperature collectors can be. These high temperature collectors can be used for power generation and also the steam cooking and group temperature, that is the parabolic trough up to 500 degrees centigrade. And these non-focusing flat plate collectors are generally consist of copper plate collectors and evacuative, that is the ETC. The two types of solar collectors are available for water heating. This is the solar collectors working principle. It simply acts like a greenhouse concept. That is the light energy. That is the light energy gets into the plate, hits on the plate or the black surface, black painted surface. That is any copper material or any conducting material has to be used as a solar flat plate collectors or any absorbing plate. That absorbed plate is coated with black paint. Black body is a good absorber of heat energy. Also, it is a good emitter of heat energy. That's it. To avoid the heat loss, you have to put the glass on the top. that glass transmits the maximum solar radiations inside the absorber plate, that reflected from the solar absorber plate or radiated from the absorber plate has to be trapped in between the glass, because this time the glass acts as a insulator, because the shortwave radiated reflected rays or has to be gets trapped inside the glass plate between the absorber plate and the glass plate. That's why the inside temperature goes on increasing. That heat energy trapped is used for the heating the liquid or fluid inside the below the absorber plate inside the tubes. That heat is transferred by the circulating water or some other fluid which has to be used as the solar heating equipment. So this type of heating concept is the minimum to maximum will have a good efficiency of around some 50 to 60% efficiency comparing with photovoltaic. Photovoltaic solar radiation conversion efficiency is around some 28% or 26%. But here, this thermal efficiency will be more than 50 to 60%. So this is a normal flat plate collector for water heating. This is a normal solar cooker to heat up the food material that has to be boiling. Any type of boiling type of food material has to be cooked up by the same concept of global warming, that is the trapping the heat energy by the black body black painted or black body boxes inside the cooker, and the reflected radiation also focused towards the boxes, and that's why there are we can cook up the food material within some 30 to 40 minutes, and so some other cloudy days we can cook up up to the 1 hour or 1.5 hours. Here the different types of solar cooker I am showing here, that is normally focusing type or reflecting type or box type cooker, these are commonly used. This is another is concept of using solar energy. We can heat up the air instead of liquid or water or oil. We can heat up the air, and using the hot air, we can dry the any drying products. That is the solar dryer. This is the, some of the different types of solar dryers we are commonly used in the market, in industries. This is the solar desalination unit. We can boil or evaporate or heat up the water that is a desalined or a wastewater that gets heated up. That heated up water has to be, it gets condensed in the bottom of the glass surface, and the slope of the surface gives up the distilled water slowly collected into the any bottle or some 1 square meter area of the distilled water unit. We can get around some 3 to 5 liters per day. This is a similar, these are all the solar thermal concepts used on the black body principle and global warming concepts. So this way here we are we have to concentrate on the three things. One thing is maximum heat absorption, maximum heat transfer, and minimum heat loss. According to that, we are working on the research areas to be mainly, we are working on that maximum heat absorbing material and maximum heat transfer material. In that two category, we have introduced the nanotechnology or nano concepts towards the solar thermal applications. This is a large scale solar desalination plant in Arizona. This is another one solar desalination plant from ocean, that is the California. There are different models are there. This is another concept of solar thermal energy. Using solar thermal, we can produce the maximum temperature of 2000 degrees centigrade to focusing lot of solar collectors or reflectors towards the top of the tower. From that, we can heat up the molten oil or salt to heat up the and run the heat up that molten oil, and we can produce steam. From that, we can run the power generating generators. There are different type of solar thermal power stations are there, but in India there is no other such a power. It requires a largest area, that is a large area is required, that is the solar field and thermal storage area and power plant. Hereby I am showing some of the California's desert. They can use the steam generators using some more than thousands of solar reflectors. That is why the thermal energy, we are requiring the three concepts, maximum heat absorption and maximum heat transfer. Here in the solar photovoltaic, the simple concept is the light energy has to be converted into electrical energy. As like as in plants, the solar cells can only absorb the specific wavelengths of light. So the light can be absorbed in a certain wavelength that has to be converted into electrical energy. So when the sunlight enters into the p-n junction of any diode, that has to be, the photons has to be absorbed by the upper layer, that has to be converted into the p-type material or n-type material. That in between that junction, we can produce the electron hole pairs. That movement of electron and hole pairs produce the electricity. In that also we can use the solar, that is the nano concepts or nanotechnology in the coming slides I am going to show you. Here the common normal efficiency of semiconductor material normally, that will be for cadmium telluride or gallium arsenide or compound alloy material has to be maximum efficiency, but the cost is very high. But commonly used for silicon as efficiency are around some 20% to 25% in normal silicon, or silicon based nano powder, that is a porosilicon concepts are commonly used, or silicon based material, we can use some other coating material as a thin film material to absorb titanium oxide or some other semiconducting oxides to absorb the maximum photons to make the maximum electrons. Now I am going to show the nanotechnology or nano concepts impacting the energy landscape. The conversion and generation area, we are using the renewables, thermoelectrics and solar fuels. And efficiency and the recycling area, we are using the green buildings, transmission resources, and capture and storage, that is the electrical storage or thermal storage, we can use the nano concepts, or in the electrical vehicle or in the public transport, we are using the nano concepts or nanotechnology. The applications of nanoparticles is commonly we all know. Generally, then in biomedical, textiles, healthcare, environment, electronics, whatever it may be, different types of nanomaterials are utilized or used or trained or researched. Research work is going on in that area. But here I am going to give the only the two areas, that is the solar thermal and solar photovoltaic area. What is nanotechnology? We all know that is the that is a nanometer range around some 100 to 100 nanometer will be now as a technical people, as a research people, you must call this as 100 nanometer will be the nano size particle. For example, salt grain, antimicrobial uses, sunscreens, cloths, and sports equipments, and quantum dots. These are all the commonly used nanoparticles in sports rackets, particularly in the tennis rackets, are very lightweight mainly due to the carbon fibers. But the strength and stability will be high. Similarly, in cloths also, they are using the nano concepts and nano powders using mixed blended textile materials. So it is one of the finest concept, because nano is a concept of changing the physical and chemical and electronic property of the material from the bulk, when it's converted from the bulk to the nano. Up to the micrometer range, that the same bulk material concept is continued. But after that, when it is reduced to 10 power minus 8 to 10 power minus 9, it will be totally changed, the drastic change in the physical and chemical or electronic property. That is the trendsetter in the field of nano concepts and nanotechnology, nanotechnology related applications. That is the idea of concept is a famous concept. There is a lot of room at the bottom. This is one of the famous physical scientist, Richard Feynman told. That means as like is in music. If you heard about any music, all the music, whether it is Carnatic, whether it is Western, whatever it may be, only the seven notes are there. Only the seven swaras are there. In between the seven swaras, there is a lot of work has to be done by the musicians or composers or whatever it may be. Similar to that, in sports also, the techniques has to be designed. The same football, the same cricket has to be played for the more than 100 years or 200 years or more than many years. But the technique has to be changed. For example, in cricket also, initially in the 1800s or 1900s, the cricket is mainly played for the test match cricket. Test match cricket mainly for the England country, mainly for the sunburst, for the environmental condition, they use the test match cricket for 5 days. At that time, they use the bats and cricket bats are used and cricket balls are totally different. Nowadays, the cricket balls and bats are totally different. That is why the technique has to be changed. And similarly, the game nature also has to be changed. From the test match, we have changed over to one day match and now to the 2020. The same concept of the bulk material to nano, the technology has to be changed only by the same concept of physical, chemical and electronic property has to be applicable or doesn't change up to the 10 power minus 6 micrometer range. And after 10 power minus 6, below 10 power minus 6, 10 power minus 7 or 10 power minus 8 to 10 power minus 9, up to the nanoscale, the physical, chemical and all the properties has to be drastically changed. That positive nature has to be mainly utilized in the nano applications. That is why nanoparticle properties has to be one of the important concepts. From the synthesis itself, we can control the shape and the dimension and the position and the property of the particular material. For example, if it is carbon, for example, if it is silver, whatever it may be, that individual particle, each atom sized, that nano sized particle, it's a scale plane, that is the lattice planes, all has to be change, it all has to be controlled by the humans using technologies or techniques from the synthesis itself. That is the nano's multifunctionality, that composition, that's size controllability, and its assemble and its surface modification. That surface modification is the one of the biggest advantage of the nanotechnology and nanoparticles. The application of nanofluids in solar energy I am going to give now. For example, in normally to heat up the to capture the solar thermal energy, we can use the black painted or black coated some material absorber plate. Below the absorber plate, we are using some fluids to make the heat absorbed from the to make the heat transferred from the absorber plate to the storage plate, the storage or load. That's why in that area we are working on that applying the nano concept. That is the nano powder mixed with some base fluid. This is called as the nanofluids. This nanofluids increase the temperature dependence on temperature intensity. For example, this type of nanofluids mainly increase the thermal conductivity at low nanoparticle concentrators. Also, the strong temperature dependence. We can increase the temperature transfer rate very much fast. Then a nonlinear increase in the thermal conductivity with nanoparticle concentration. Then the increase in the boiling, the critical heat flux. So these type of positive features has to be mainly the advantage of the nanofluids in thermal systems, particularly in solar. Because solar is available only during the daytime, from the morning 9 to morning afternoon 4. That will be the maximum solar radiation we are available throughout the world. India is blessed with the solar throughout. Out of 365 days, we are getting solar energy around some 250 days good solar radiation. A good solar radiation means around 1,000 watt per meter square. Above 800 watt per meter square per day is a good solar radiation. So in India, in the western part of India, particularly Gujarat and Rajasthan, and southern part of India, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, and Andhra, particularly Andhra and Tamil Nadu, is blessed with solar throughout the year. Out of 365 days, we are getting solar energy, heat energy, both light and heat, around some 300 days. That is why this type of nanofluids can increase the efficiency of the solar thermal equipments by absorbing the heat transfer rate, by increase the thermal conductivity rate. That is why it is a promising discoveries and potentials in emerging fields for the solar thermal applications. This is the picture shows the phase changing mechanism of the nanofluids. The total heat transfer, heat absorption rate, when the temperature is increased from this area, the phase change will, nanoparticles phase change will, the thermal conductivity value has to be increased. From the base fluid, it is normal, commonly we are using the nanofluid, nano powder has to be mixed with some base fluid. I'm going to show the, what are the types of base fluids or nanopowders has to be used. That base fluid temperature is not changing thermal absorption value, but the phase change value of that nano powder, that will increase the thermal conductivity or thermal energy storage of that particular nanofluids. That's why the thermal conductivity value mainly depend on the temperature, the base fluid, and the particle concentration, clustering effect, the clusters, that is the clusters found in the nano powder material, that is the nanoparticles, and the pH value of the material, and particle shape, whether it is in the, that is why the shape, the synthesis is the important factor to design the nanoparticles shape, and the particle motion and particle size. So this nanofluids practical application generally in solar thermal, not only in solar thermal, in all other areas also we are using the nanofluids. But here in solar thermal, mostly used nanoparticles are silicon dioxide or magnesium based oxides or aluminum oxides, titanium oxides. All the semiconductor metal oxides has to be blended with the base material that that has to be used as a good solar thermal nanofluids applications. That is in flat plate collectors or evacuative collectors, direct absorbers or parabolic trough or solar dish or solar thermal. Nanofluids are the base fluids of water, ethylene, glycol, oils has to be used as a base fluids in normally. But for as a nanoparticle in metals, copper, Ag and nickel and Au has to be used. In metal oxides, copper oxides, titanium oxides, aluminum iron oxides and silicon oxides, zinc oxides has to be used. Also in the carbon materials, CNT, carbon nanotubes are has to be mixed with, blended with the base fluids. That is the, whether it is a water or ethylene or glycol or oil or some other thing. Similarly, metal nitrates like Bn and An and metal carbides as SiC. So this nanoparticles combination plus base fluid has to be the hybrid nanofluids concept, has to be mainly increase the efficiency of the solar thermal equipment, which will be more than 60% to 70%, which will give the better efficiency than comparing with the commercial conventional thermal equipments. Some more nanomaterials composites with the nanofluids. Single wall carbon nanotubes, particularly in carbon nanotubes, single wall carbon nanotubes with the solar heat exchanger concept we can use, and ferrous nanoparticles in nitrate, salt, etc. For concentrated solar power, focusing type concentrated solar powers, and also for oxides based nanoparticle dispersal in carbonate salt. That will be used for concentrated solar power systems, and multi-walled carbon nanotube nanofluids for flat plate solar collectors and carbon narrow walls. That is the multi-wall, that is a multi-layer carbon nanotube, CNT, for solar thermal collectors and metal nanofluids, particularly for direct solar absorption, as like as in solar water heaters or solar cookers like that. So generally this type of nanofluids is mainly very advantageous. So in that area, the research and studies are very, very less. So there is a lot of scope in that area, particularly in solar thermal nanofluids. This is the another picture shows how the binary nanofluids rotating on the magnetic field concept. That is where the efficiency will increase. The thermal efficiency will increase by the nanofluids concept. So the efficiency of the nanofluid based solar collector, mainly the upper side of this collector is covered by glass. It is act as a transmitter, also as a insulator, because the incoming solar radiation has to be allowed inside the absorber plate. The outgoing solar radiation with a little bit wavelength change, that has to be trapped. That's why the glass plate acts as an insulator. This allows the high frequency radiation entering the absorber and acts as a trap for the low frequency radiation going out. Why the lower side of the glass is well insulated, that is the solar system. The other top surface is covered with glass. Other four, five sides has to be covered with insulating material like mineral wool, glass wool, or some other non-commercial product like thermocol or coconut waste or some other cotton waste. This insulating material prevents the heat loss from the bottom and other sides. Then the working fluid is a mixture of water and aluminium nanoparticles. Here, whatever it may be, this is the working fluid, some nano fluid. But how we can calculate the efficiency? The efficiency is based on the useful gain by the available energy. That is a M, that is the flow rate of the fluid. The flow rate is the important concept. According to the flow rate, the heat absorption and heat transfer rate has to be dependent. That is why the flow rate is important concept. Another thing is specific capacity of the coefficient material, that material, that fluid. That specific coefficient of the absorber plate, specific coefficient of the nanofluid, or the fluid below the absorber plate, are the basic thing to get the maximum, that is a useful gain. Another thing is outlet temperature and inlet temperature. These are the temperatures used, and A is the area of the collector, that is in square meters. So these all give the total value of the efficiency of the solar collector. So in that area, the specific capacity of the material, that is the fluid, heat transfer fluid, or the absorber material are the major factors. That's why we are working mainly on that working fluid, that is the which specific capacity, that heat transfer capacity, that thermal conductivity has to be increased by using the nanopowder as a nanofluid. Then another thing is coating. Coating is on the absorber plate. Absorber plate is coated with some black painted coat. Normal black paint is commonly not used. It is called as a selective coating. Selective coating is a thin layer of finely divided nickel black or chromium black. That is the black chromium is formed on the surface by electrolysis process. It is a monopoly. Only few companies use this technique to produce a selective coated absorber plates in India. Such a layer has the property that it absorbs the solar energy almost as well as matte black surface, but it is poor emitter of energy at the temperature of the base metal. That is why this type of selective coating is done, means that lower conductivity of an aluminum sheet can be compensated by having it run hotter. That's why the heat transfer rate has to be increased. Heat absorber rate has to be increased. The second advantage of selective coating is that it is enable the collector to work better in poor condition. That is a weak sunshine. When the cloudy days also, we can absorb the maximum heat energy. That is the one of the biggest advantage of the selective coating compared with the normal black coating. Now, to improve this selective coating, the absorber plates are usually made up of some metals, aluminium or copper or some other iron materials. Because of the metal is a good heat conductor, we are using this type of selective coating. Just a minute. Nice. The spectral selective coating. This selective coating based, there are, we are using the two types of selective coating surfaces, non-selective and moderate selective surfaces. The selective surfaces with good efficiency have absorption value, that is solar absorptance value has to be increased by the good selective coating material. And thermal emittance, that is another thing, the emitted fraction, the absorbivity and emissivity ratio will be the important concept for the good selective concept, good selective coating. The selective absorbers can accomplish this requirement by having high solar absorbivity and high thermal reflectivity simultaneously. That is why the picture and the graphical representation shows the solar spectrum range, the infrared radiation, that is the black body radiation, is mainly is ideal for the selective coating concept to absorb the maximum heat energy. This is another picture. That is the substrate, the IR layer, and the absorber layer, and anti-reflective layer. These are all based on the ideal solar selective coating and based on the input radiation, that is the black body radiation. These are the different materials used for the selective coating concept: graphene oxide film, or carbon nanotube array, or carbonized wood, or black titanium nanocages, and different selective coating materials. In the right side, I am showing the some of the from the natural wood, the green leaf, to the different absorbing material pictures. This selective absorber with multi-layer cermet for high temperatures, which can stable up to 500 to 600 degrees centigrade. Normally, the solar water heating collectors or thermal absorbers, the absorber plate can withstand the temperature up to 200 or 100 degree or 110 or 150 degrees centigrade. That solar absorptance will be value will be more than or equivalent to 95%, and thermal emittance will be less than 10% or 400 degrees centigrade. That is why the polished low carbon steel as a substrate material or W aluminium oxide multi-layer cermet coating has to be used in this experiment to increase the selective coating, that to use it as a selective coating material to increase the solar absorbance value. Now I am going to show the nano concepts in the base of solar cells. In conventional solar cells, we are using the normal silicon or some other material in a PN junction diode, which can absorb the trap the solar photons that has to be converted into electricity. But in a nanostructured solar cell, the concept is a little bit different. To absorb the maximum photons and to minimize the electron hole pair recombination, the nano coating on the solar cell, which is absorbed 60% or more UV and IR rays. That is the important concept of the nano concept, nano-based nanotechnology in the solar cell absorptions. There are generally, we are commonly using three generations of solar cells. One is wafer-based, another is thin-film-based, another is low-cost and high-efficiency. The first generation, second generation, and third generation. The third generation is in the till now in the lab condition. I think now another person is going to give on the organic solar cells tomorrow. Just I'm going to give the what are the concepts used in the nano based in the silicon based solar cells in the today. Yes, the porous silicon. This is a concept we are working on, that porous based structure. We have to improve the texture of that surface of the silicon solar cell or any subsolar cells by increasing, by changing the texture of the surface of any solar cell material. That will increase the large surface areas and amount of active sites. That is why the open structures for fast charge and mass transfer has to be possible, and strong mechanical properties minimizing the structural degradation. That is why the stability of the solar cell has to be improved, and the structures of whole structures releasing self-restricting 2D nanosheets. For example, that is why the porous silicon has to be implemented from 1980. It is a concept by Ur, a Russian scientist, in 1980s, due to its porous nature of rough surface, a low refractiveness has to be possible on the surface, and a blue shift fundamental absorption is has to be developed, which is one of the concept of quantum confinement. The surface of the porous silicon is highly texturized, which enhances the light trapping and reduces the reflection losses by the low refractive index nature. It can be used for creation of ARC. That is the anti-reflection coating concept. It has to be implemented on the solar cell by increasing the anti-reflection. By increasing the anti-reflection nature of the solar cell, then light trap has to be increased. Photon traps has to be increased. The possibility of the technological control of the band gap has to be possible by the porosilicon concept, which may be utilized to optimize the sunlight absorption. Its wide band gap make it a candidate for window layer for heterojunction solar cell. Here is the picture of a porosilicon based it's some picture. Yes, the porous layer can be made structurally uniform. That is why by using your porosilicon has to be prepared from the etching and the normal silicon. That is as prepared silicon from the using HFL as electrolyte and using etching technique, electrolysis technique. This porous layer can be made structurally uniform if I'm using the ethonic solution is used. This increases the wettability of the silicon and allows better surface. By increasing the wettability, hydrophobic surface has to be possible. By increasing the hydrophobic surface, we can the reflectivity nature of the surface has to be minimized. That is why the light can be separated into different wavelengths. Only photons can be absorbed and generate the electron hole pair. The reflection at the same angle. That is why the untextured surface, the texturized surface on the right, the reflection is at the same angle. At least the second reflection is not possible. Also, the effective absorption length of the silicon layer will be reduced. That is, the lower refractive index has to be possible. The area of the surface becomes bigger. Total reflection on the side of the front layer is also possible. By texturing, formed by anisotropic etching, different crystal planes etch at different rates. That is the another advantage. And it reduces the total internal reflection by reflecting light into the another pyramid instead of away. It has to be trapped within the pyramid. By increasing the chances of absorbing the light 30% reflection from polished silicon, it reduced to 10% for textured silicon, less loss of reflection. Also, the textured surface, the textured dimension are of the order of 1 to 10 micrometer. Such a large scale geometries are not suitable for thin film cells. That's why it increases the minority carrier surface recombination. That is why it also due to the greater surface area, reducing the collection efficiency of the photogenerator. Now, some new approaches, that is, some novel approaches are needed for photon injection management. That is to increase the absorption photon more, the light trapping without texturing on both thick and thin silicon solar cells. So, in the thin film concept, this type of texturization is not much possible, but in the silicon substrate, normal silicon substrate, we can possible. Porous silicon is a sponge like structure with a disordered nanostructure. Some nanostructure will be in the range of 1 to 100 nanometer. The large surface area has to be possible around some 600 meters square per centimeter square. And it will be categorized into three categories. It is microporous, mesoporous. Microporous will be the two, it is the minimum pore size, that is less than 2 nanometer. And mesoporous will be around some 2 to 50 nanometer. And macroporous will be the greater than 50 nanometer, will be called as macroporous silicon material. So the PL picture, photoluminescence studies are normally in the visible region of 1.4 to 2 electron volt. That is the for band gap value. And the porous silicon layer, has to be, the parameters has to be defined by the porosity. That is by increasing or decreasing the porosity. That's why we can increase the size of the granite, grains, that is the particles. And the thickness and the morphology has to be controlled by the HF concentration, anodization time, and the etching current density. These are the factors can control the porosity, thickness, and morphology. That is the size of the particles. Also, by controlling these concepts, the porosity, thickness, and morphology, we can control the developed grain size. By controlling that, we can produce the less dimensioned porous particles of crystal silicon. By that, we can achieve the quantum conformity in the blue region. So, by the stability of this type of porosilicon material has to be done using by aging to exposure to ambient air. This is the nano and micro porous size sponge like structure, and there's a little bit sponge like structure that the sponge's location design has to be a little bit changed in the mesoporous and macroporous. It's not looks like a sponge like structure. It will be some window like structures. This will be the common technique commonly used for silicon wafer to porous silicon. It is an electrochemical etching technique using ethanol and HF hydrofluoric acid in some single tank method or some other technique. This picture we can see that this is the pores in between these two silicon rods. These silicon grinds or rods has to be the size, and this pore size has to be controlled by the concentration or current density or the etching time. That the time. These are the parameters. From the porous silicon slip, by using the, you can develop the anodization and other techniques. This type of porous silicon material has to be mainly used for, say, used for sensor based applications and also the light trapping photo optoelectronic applications in more. Here I am showing the just how much light has to be, photons has to be absorbed in the porous silicon. This unmodified, there's untexturized silicon solar cells away from the light energy in the form of reflection. So most solar cells have some kind of anti-reflecting particle. We need some type of anti-reflection, that is the ARC, on the type of porous silicon substrate or some other solar cell substrate by some other technique. But here, by making some extra, to avoid such extra coating, a fabrication of submicron structure by using the etching technique, or some texturing technique, or simple wet treatment, we can produce some pores or some texture of the nature in the silicon surface, which give its own anti-reflective coating technology. That's why in Osaka University of Japan, they developed this type of wetting technique. Using that, they passivate the submicron silicon structures with the heat surface area to prevent the recombination loss by deposition of phosphosilicate glass followed by heat treatment. That's why this method can simultaneously form a p-n junction. So to separate the photogenerated electrons, electrons and hole separation has to be possible, and also therefore it will act as an ARC. That is the anti-reflective coating concept on the top. In the left we have shown the incident light without texturing, and the texturing with the normal concept etching technique. And the new concept of developer technology, that the textured nature has to be submicron structure. That's why the incident light has to be no reflection. Maximum photons has to be absorbed by the silicon layer. This is the picture shows the cross sectional view of a lateral anodization cell using a common beaker or both type electrolysis technique to prepare a porous silicon. And in the right side, we are using a single tank technique, the cross single tank technique to produce the porous silicon. By preparing this type of two technique or some other etching technique, we can control, we can change the edge scale planes of the silicon. That's why the lattice planes has to be changed or branched, their design has to be changed in the micro, macro, nano level. That's why we can control the absorption or the electrical or optical property of that semiconducting material, crystalline nature of the material. Normally, the solar material efficiency, solar cell material efficiency will be based on that first generation, second generation, third generation, fourth generation, and different materials. Even though still now, the single crystal silicon have a maximum efficiency up to 28% normally. But the cost is a little bit high to produce a single crystal solar cell. It will be around some per watt, around some 12 rupees per watt now in the market. But for the polycrystalline or multicrystalline or some other solar cells, the stability will be the biggest drawback of the other type of solar cells. Only the silicon-based substrate or silicon-based solar cells has to be good stability and little bit cost-effective and a little bit efficiency comparing with other solar cells. Yeah. This type of nano concepts or nano materials has to be used in all categories of energy, particularly energy storage or energy transmission or energy distribution or energy change or energy storage and energy usage. In energy sources, we can use it in solar cell there is a photovoltaic concept we can use in wind energy development, we can use in geothermal concept in renewable energy, and hydro in tidal power, we can use the nano concept in biomass energy, we can use the nano concept similarly in the fossil fuel concept, and in nuclear also. Nuclear energy is one of the green energy type of a green energy concept commonly used throughout the world. Around some 450 nuclear power reactors are working throughout the world. In India, only 21 reactors are working, power reactors, that is power generating reactors. But in USA, around some 102 reactors are functioning in USA itself. In France, 80% of the electrical energy is coming from nuclear power. That's why this type of green energy concepts are focusing or putting our economy towards green economy. That is why these green energy concepts or energy sources as to it, we are marching towards the renewable energy, particularly solar, wind, geo, tidal, or and bio energy like that. Worldwide, many countries are switching over to the renewable energy based power generators. Around some 20% of the countries are increasing, switching over to the solar power and photovoltaic and wind. 162 countries and 135 countries are working towards the renewable regular policies. And 100 gigawatt of solar photovoltaic power has to be mostly produced from the new technology and concept. So 30 countries have more than 10 gigawatt of renewable energy power capacity. In India, around some, till now we are working towards the solar energy concept. Solar photovoltaic power generators in Tamil Nadu itself, we are having some 2,200 megawatt of solar power generations. Similarly, the jobs towards the renewable energy based concepts. Around some 10 million related jobs are possible in Asia itself towards the renewable energy related sector. This is the picture shows the how much the energy share in India and Tamil Nadu. In the installed combination generation capacity in Tamil Nadu, around some 200 megawatt from coal and only 82, that is a 23% from 200 gigawatt from coal and just 82 gigawatt from renewable energy, that is the wind and solar and other bioenergies in 2019 like that. But in India also we are having the most from coal and other oil. This is the Indian picture impact of solar energy demand in India. From 2009 onwards till now, we are moving towards the solar energy. More than 8,000 megawatt of solar energy power plants already installed. 8,000 to 9,000 megawatt of solar power has to be produced in India itself. Solar photovoltaic power. In Tamil Nadu, sir, we are having one of the biggest solar power plant in southern Tamil Nadu, in Kamudi area by Adani Group, some 634 megawatt power solar power has to be used. But the solar thermal area, we are mainly industrial solar water heaters are commonly used in India, around some 10 lakh solar water heaters. That is more than few crore liters of hot water has to be produced from solar thermal energy. In Karnataka state, many of the homes and residents and hospitals, hotels are mainly using solar water heaters for more than 20-30 years. But in Tamil Nadu still, we are not having such awareness on solar thermal applications. But throughout India, the solar thermal applications and throughout the world, the solar thermal applications should not have a very good awareness. And its application and the research is not much popular as equivalent to the solar photovoltaic related applications and research. This is the jobs available in the solar energy sector in 2020. Around 624,600 skilled people, semi-skilled people for construction commissioning. Also some 182,200 people are required for construction commissioning for skilled laborers. Also in the operation and maintenance, semi-skilled and skilled are some 81,000 and 182,000. And in the business development and marketing and purchasing and sales, some 70,000 and in the design and pre-construction, that is totally some 1 crore and 11 lakh thousands of jobs are possible in the solar sector as now trend is going on towards that. So this type of this exploitation this exploitation, the present and the future overtaking of solar energy mainly compromises the development of the novel technology for optimum protection from the available natural resources and environmental awareness and the energy awareness and better management and distribution system is very much required. And like the other domains, the artificial intelligence, that is the AI, would assist in achieving the future goals of solar energy research. That is why this related concept has to be mainly in the area of predetermination of the solar related research and other things. The theoretical works on solar energy based studies has to be very much important. That's why the AI based concept has to be very much needed in that area. The statistical and biologically inspired artificial learning methods have been implemented in several studies to achieve common and future aims. So, solar energy based thermal and photovoltaic concepts and equipments have a lot of opportunities and scopes towards the power generation. So in that area, the research is marching towards the nano-based applications or nano-based science or nano-based technology in solar thermal and photovoltaic applications. In our college also, we are having some few solar energy-based experiments and research is going on. And few solar power is very commonly used throughout all of the education in Tamil Nadu and India. This is our APJ Abdul Kalam's concept. Our contribution promotion of energy utilization is a major share with the energy when energy independence is much earlier than 2020. That's why energy is a major, utilization of solar energy is one of the important concept along with other renewable energy, that is the wind. In Tamil Nadu, we are very much strong in renewable energy, particularly in wind energy. Our wind energy potential is more than 7,000 to 8,000 megawatt, but solar energy potential is still now 2,000 to 3,000 megawatt. That's why our contribution promotion of energy utilization is a major share when the energy independence can be much easily attainable earlier than 2020, but we are still delayed by using the solar energy, which can bring energy independence before 2020. Now we are in 2020, so we need more such research and more such concept awareness towards solar energy related area. Thank you. Hello.
Hello, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yes. Hear me. Hear you.
Yeah, fine, sir. Thank you so much for your wonderful talk, sir. Actually, there are a few questions from the audience.
Yes.
So far, I have muted that. I'll tell read out those questions. Can you answer, sir?
Yes, sure.
Yeah,
sure.
Fine, sir. The question from J. Tirupati, AP Physics.
Yes.
Which type of solar cells exhibit the highest conversion efficiency? This is the question from
Gallium gallium arsenide based solar cells are cadmium telluride. But cadmium telluride and gallium arsenide are both are compound material. So that's why the cost effective is not suitable for that type of solar. But the efficiency is a little better. It will be around some 30% it will be possible in that type of compound material.
Fine, sir. How can we decide the thickness of absorbing layer in thin film solar cells?
Yes. The thickness of the thin film has to be decided by some laser technique or some reflectometer study. We can get that thickness. Laser-based reflectometer reflector study will give the thickness of the material. Also, some gravimetry theoretical methods also available in that area.
Another question from Dr. S. Sivaranjani. Will nanofluids replace the nanosubstance, or in which place we can use nanofluids?
Yes. Nanofluids mostly used in the automobile area, they can use for lubrications area. But here in thermal science, in thermal physics and thermal applications, we can use to absorb the heat energy and we can use it for the heat transfer area. So some particular nanomaterials have a capacity of maximum thermal conductivity and maximum heat storage capacity. That's why the heat capacity and heat conductivity nature, that type of nano powder has to be blended with some base fluids. That has to be prepared as a nano fuel. That has to be used to increase the thermal efficiency of the particular material.
Thanks, sir. So another question from Dr. P.S. Satish Kumar. Which yes. technique suitable or more efficient for thin film solar cell? Which technique thin. Suitable or more efficient for thin film solar cell?
Yes. Normally, thin film solar cell has to be prepared by the normal dip coating technique. There are the different techniques to prepare a thin film on any substrate material. You can use a glass as a substrate material normally for a trial and error method. After that, you can go for ITO or FTO or any other conducting oxides or conducting base material substrate. So on that, you can prepare a thin film by using a dip coating technique or spin coating or sputtering or DC sputtering or whether it is a magnetron sputtering or using some other thermal evaporation technique or other spray technique. There are different techniques are possible. But according to that technique, you can prepare a crystalline nature of the film is very efficient, important. That is why the parameters is main important thing to prepare a thin film. So the technique is different and the parameters are different according to that technique. That is why the simple technique is not so very simple technique is a dip coating, but very effective films are not possible using dip coating. Spray or spin is a very cost effective technique to prepare a normal good solar cell.
Yeah, fine, sir. Another question, sir. How can we calculate theoretically pore width and pore volume of metal oxides?
Pore volume of a metal oxides?
Pore width. Yes. And pore volume of metal oxides.
Yes. Normally, we can from the SEM image also we can calculate this. From the SEM image, they have to give you scales in the SEM image. From the scales, we can calculate by normal basic technique. From the SEM image itself, we can calculate the pore size and pore wall. Other than that, some gravimetric calculations are available in the theoretical studies. That type of calculations has to be utilized. Some two types of calculations are commonly used in the gravimetry calculations to measure the pore size and pore walls. Pore size.
Okay.
By calculating the pore size, we can calculate the granite, that the grain size or the particle size.
Sir, another question from Dr. S. Singaram. Yes. Is there any correlation between porous size and efficiency?
Yes, sure. Sure. Okay. If the pore size goes on increasing, the in between the pores, the grain size goes on decreasing. So by decreasing the grain size, that is the crystalline nature gets increased. When the crystalline nature gets increased, that the particle size is decreased, the crystalline nature gets increased. When the good quality crystalline natured particles has to be available in between the pores. At that time, the crystalline nature is, when the crystalline nature is the optical, that is the PL efficiency will be shifted towards the blue. Blue shift has to be possible. By that, we can attain the quantum confinement principle concept. That concept is attained, then we can get the good efficient output.
Fine, sir. Another question, sir.
Yes.
In case DSSC, porous size doesn't change the efficiency.
Dicentesis solar cells?
Yes, sir. In case DSSC, porous size doesn't change the efficiency.
In DSSC, porous size doesn't change the efficiency.
Yeah. Fine, sir. I hope, I think all the questions have been answered, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. This is a very energetic and wonderful talk, sir.
Thank you.
We had a very beautiful session. Not only here, even people are watching in live streaming. About 300 to 400 people are watching there. So on the whole, a large number of participants entirely invited with your talks.
Thank you very much. I am very much thankful to the St. Joseph College of Engineering. And thank you to one of the coordinators, Mr. Sambath, and all other coordinators. And thank you, madam. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So on the whole, with this session, the session ends, and hope you all enjoy, and meet you tomorrow. I have shared the feedback form in chat. Please kindly fill it up so that I can end the session.
Copy. Live stream. We will paste one more.
I have shared the feedback form in chat. Please kindly fill it up so that I can.